Hello and welcome. It's 10 a.m. on Monday, the 24th of November. You're tuned in to our mid-morning newscast here on Arirang TV. Thanks for joining us. I'm Mark Broome. Let's take a look at what's making the headlines. Amid the country's chronically low birth rate and aging population, women are expected to outnumber men in Korea for the first time next year. The number of elderly will also surpass the number of children under 14 years of age in just 3 years' time. South Korea condemns North Korea's aggressive rhetoric following a UN resolution on its human rights issues and calls on Pyongyang to take the resolution seriously. Plus, in one of the deadliest attacks so far this year, a suicide bomber kills at least 45 people at a volleyball match in eastern Afghanistan. But we start with news that Korea's chronically low birth rate and its rapidly aging population are about to bring about a historically significant shift in the ratio of women to men in the country, showing us how things are expected to change in the coming years. Shin Se-min reports.
The nation's population is about to undergo a major change in the next year. Women will outnumber men for the first time since 1960. Statistics Korea predicts that the number of women will stand at over 25.31 million by 2015, outnumbering men by 10,000. The agency attributed the change to two major social issues facing the country: the low birth rate and the rapid aging of the population. There are still more boys born in Korea than girls, but given that women have a longer life expectancy than men, their numbers will still be higher overall. But that's not all. The number of people over the age of 65 is also expected to grow rapidly to more than 7.1 million by 2017, from 6.4 million this year. The nation first became an aging society in the year 2000, when just 7% of the population was over 65. But at the current rate, the country could become a super-age society in 2026, when over 20% of its population will be over 65. Given these trends, the labor force is expected to fall, eventually pulling down the nation's growth rate. Experts say that to combat the low birth rate and aging population, and to prevent the economic growth rate falling in the longer term, the government must utilize a workforce of women, the elderly, and foreigners, and programs and services for these groups must be improved. Shin Se-min, Arirang News.
And experts are having their say on what the government needs to do to boost Korea's very low birth rate. They are calling for long-term investment in policies aimed at trying to reverse this trend. But they say building public trust in these measures is the first and most critical step. Our Kim Min-ji reports.
There was a time in the not-so-distant past when Korea promoted birth control and encouraged families to have fewer children. In the 1980s, the nation's population topped 40 million, and the government, acting on the fear that overpopulation would take a toll on food and housing supplies, rolled out a one-child campaign. It worked, and now, along with other factors, Korea has one of the lowest birth rates in the world.
Latest figures show that Korea's average fertility rate, which represents the number of children a woman is expected to have during her lifetime, is estimated at 1.3. That's the third lowest among 198 countries and well below the world average of 2.5.
Whether it be the high cost of raising a child or more women choosing their careers over motherhood, a growing number of couples are deciding to hold off on having kids. 29-year-old teacher Park Eun-ju says it's why she isn't a mom yet, even though she's been married for 2 years.
If I have a baby, my life will have to be centered around the child. Also, after becoming a mother, I may not be able to get a good enough job, and this will then lower my overall standard of living.
Park and others like her hope the government will offer more incentives like higher family support allowances and tax breaks to encourage women to give birth. However, OECD data shows the Korean government's spending to GDP on such benefits is one of the lowest among member nations. Some experts also say Korea's hyper-competitive society could be another factor keeping the fertility rate down.
If the government gives parents assurances that their children will be able to enjoy a standard level of happiness by getting an average education and landing an average job and working diligently, then the birth rate will naturally go up.
The expert added the government will have to invest more money and time into strengthening its child care and welfare policies to build public trust in the measures before it can expect to see the birth rate improve. Kim Min-ji, Arirang News.
Now, Korea, China and Japan are resuming their free trade negotiations in Tokyo on this Monday. Korea's trade ministry says the three countries will focus on negotiation principles for tariff concessions and ways to liberalize the service sector and investments. And the chief negotiators will meet separately away from the working level talks in a bid to hopefully speed up the process. After recently conducting FTA negotiations with China, Korea plans to more actively push for this trilateral trade pact and the ASEAN-led regional comprehensive economic partnership. Seoul, Beijing and Tokyo have discussed a wide range of areas from goods, services, intellectual property, all the way to the environment since launching these negotiations 2 years ago, but progress has been very slow. With only about 1 week left before the parliamentary deadline to pass next year's budget, Korea's main rival political parties are engaged in the tug of war over the government's cigarette price hike and corporate taxes. Speculation is mounting that the National Assembly Speaker will likely attach the contested cigarette price-related bills to the budget, which would allow him to introduce the bills at the plenary session on December 1st if the parties fail to agree on them by the end of the month. The ruling party says the cigarette bill should be attached to the budget as the price hike would account for a large part of tax revenue. The opposition side says raising cigarette prices and thereby imposing more taxes on ordinary citizens should be accompanied by a hike on corporate taxes. The opposition party is even looking at potentially boycotting parliamentary proceedings. The floor leaders of the two parties plan to talk over the two issues as well as other budget concerns on Tuesday. South Korea says North Korea should take last week's UN resolution condemning its human rights violations very seriously, saying there will be consequences for Pyongyang if it carries out its latest series of threats. Our Jim Young-gil reports.
South Korea has condemned North Korea for threatening to retaliate against a recent UN resolution on the North's human rights violations, saying that the international community will respond firmly to any provocations from Pyongyang. Seoul's foreign ministry said in a statement on Sunday that Pyongyang should take the UN resolution seriously. In response to North's threat to conduct another nuclear test, South Korea said that in doing so, Pyongyang would only increase its isolation from the international community. Seoul's comments follow a statement from the North National Defense Commission released earlier Sunday via the Korean News Central Agency, calling the UN resolution a U.S.-led attempt to encroach on the North's sovereignty. The commission, North Korea's most powerful military body, called on U.S. President Barack Obama to apologize for favoring passage of the draft UN resolution and called the move a criminal act by Washington. The statement also highlights the North's generosity in freeing two American detainees earlier this month and says that by stirring up the North human rights issues, the U.S. was being ungrateful. Japan, the European Union and South Korea were also called out for helping the resolution to pass. But Pyongyang thanked China and Russia for voting against the resolution. The KCNA also reported Sunday that North Korean leader Kim Jong-un guided a joint military drill and called for army units to reinforce their operational command. Kim also called for frequent joint military exercises to bolster the regime's war deterrent capabilities. The leader's actions follow threats made by the North on Thursday when it vowed to strengthen its war deterrence against what it deems hostile powers. Pyongyang withdrew from the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons in 2003. Kim Young-gil, Arirang News.
Now, competition is heating up among three competitors vying to win Korea's project to procure four aerial tankers as the Korean Air Force aims to hopefully boost the amount of time its jets can stay up in the air. Our Son Jung-in reports.
As it stands now, Korea's F-15K fighter jets can operate for a maximum of 30 minutes over Korea's easternmost Dokdo Island and even less over the country's southernmost Yeouido Island. The military is seeking ways to introduce a refueling aircraft system to extend the jet's operation time and generally strengthen its military capability. Boeing's KC-46 is a leading contender in the bidding process. The aerial tanker can carry up to 96 tons of fuel and up to 114 passengers with a cargo capacity of 188 tons. On top of its decent fuel efficiency and cheap operating costs, the aircraft is also fairly compact, which means it's able to land on relatively small airfields.
Really builds on the legacy of the 75 years of experience of the Boeing company with refueling aircraft. It's also interoperable with the U.S. Air Force and all of the coalition forces as well.
The only concern is that its development is expected to be completed in 2017, the same year the Korean Air Force plans to deploy the aerial tankers. Airbus's A330 MRTT, another potential candidate, is already developed and ready to go into operation. The tanker is huge, capable of carrying 260 people, 111 tons of fuel, and 37 tons of cargo, and is still able to conduct a variety of air-to-air refueling missions.
The A330 MRTT is capable of providing more fuel, transporting more passengers and more payload during the same mission, and that is why we have won every single competition outside the U.S.
However, its applicability and landing is relatively limited due to its bulky size. Another strong challenger is Israel's IAI. It's offering a tanker based on the second-hand civil aircraft for around half the price of its competitors. Seoul is expected to announce the winner of the defense acquisition program deal worth $1.3 billion early next year. Son Jung-in, Arirang News.
A South Korean consortium will test transfer 40,000 tons of Russian coal from the Najin port in North Korea to the south's southeastern port city of Pohang from this Monday. The South Korean delegation will be in North Korea until Friday and carry out a technological inspection of the overall land and sea distribution process. Coal from a mine in West Siberia will be delivered from Hasan to Najin by rail. It will then be shipped on a Chinese tanker and arrive in Pohang on Friday. Now in global news this morning, more horror in Afghanistan. A suicide blast has killed dozens of people who were just innocently watching a volleyball game in the east of the country. We connect to Eunice Kim at the News Center for more on this and other headlines around the world. Good morning, Eunice.
Hello, Mark.
So what was supposed to be an evening of fun and games really at this village quickly turned deadly.
Right, Mark. No one has claimed responsibility yet for the suicide attack, but we do know that it dealt a heavy blow, killing at least 45 people and wounding some 60 others. It happened in a small village in Afghanistan's Paktika province, where three local volleyball teams were to go head-to-head in a tournament final. Officials said the number of casualties was high because spectators had come from neighboring districts for that game, and a vested bomber had apparently detonated himself in the middle of the match past 5 p.m. on Sunday local time. The attack came as Afghani lawmakers had approved a measure that would allow American and NATO soldiers to remain in the country into next year, even after most foreign troops withdraw in December. Volleyball is a popular form of entertainment in rural Afghanistan, and sports like boxing and soccer had been banned during the years of Taliban rule through 2001.
Yes, very sad all round. And let's shift over now to the Middle East and the already tense relations between Israelis and Palestinians have ratcheted up a notch, it's fair to say, after a Palestinian farmer was shot dead by Israeli troops on the Gaza Strip on Sunday.
Indeed, it is the first fatality since an August truce that ended the brutal 50-day war, you'll remember, this summer in Gaza. The Palestinian Health Ministry identified the deceased as 32-year-old Fidel Mohammed Halawa, who families say was hunting for songbirds that nest in that border area to sell on the market in order to feed his children. Gaza's emergency services spokesman said a bullet appeared to have entered the farmer through his back from an army watchtower near the border fence. The Israeli military only said its forces had fired warning shots at two approaching individuals before firing at their, quote, lower extremities, hitting one person. Now Israel has long designated its border area with Gaza an off-limits zone for Palestinians on concerns of militant attacks.
Well, certainly seems to be heating up over there. Yes, again. On a related note, Eunice, the Israeli cabinet has approved a controversial bill that would define Israel as a Jewish state, and this is sure to annoy Arabs living in the country.
Yeah, you know, some people may not realize that Israel does have an Arab minority. Arabs and Christians, in fact, make up some 20% of Israel's population. And critics of the nation state bill, among them are cabinet ministers, they say the proposed law would give what's called national rights for Jews that are not extended to the religious minority, thereby undermining the country's democratic foundation and potentially formalizing a second-class citizenry. After a reported bitter debate, that bill was approved by cabinet members on Sunday, 17-4, with the legislation to be brought before parliament on Wednesday this week for a parliamentary ratification. And Mark, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who said that equal rights will be given to every citizen, but the so-called national rights would only be extended to Jews. He explained the law was necessary to cement Israel as the homeland of the Jewish people on the world stage.
Well, we'll have to watch for the final wording on that document, and I'm sure you'll keep us updated. Thank you very much, Eunice.
You bet.
Now, it's often praised around the world, but it's also called obsessive in other areas. It's Korea's education fervor. And to quell the thirst for more and better quality education, local education companies here in Korea are constantly upgrading their materials. For a look at how Korea's education content providers are expanding into the global arena, here's our Gwon-soo with this week's Industry Insight.
The school bell doesn't signal the end of the day for many Korean students. They are out of their classrooms, but private tutors are waiting for them. And this nearly $30 billion industry has given birth to advanced learning products. And some of them are finding their way overseas.
Combine the eagerness of Korean parents to educate their children at the earliest age possible and the craze for English. And it's no wonder that the English education market for young children is booming. Tintin English publishes storybooks for preschoolers in China and Thailand. They say Korea is 10 to 20 years ahead of many other Asian countries when it comes to teaching English as a foreign language. Chongsang Language School recently signed a contract with major U.S. book distributor IPG, and its products recorded sales of around $20,000 in their first 2 months on Amazon. Experts say assessing the current market volume of overall exports is difficult, but Professor Lee Hyun-chung of Hanyang University estimates it's in the tens of millions of dollars and has doubled in the span of a year.
Korea already has a good image as a very strong education country all over the world. Plus, we have a very strong IT techniques, so IT-based kind of learning package and the teaching package and the content development really attractive to foreign countries. That's combine these two, we can have easily have a second K wave, it's called the educational wave, I think.
Cheongdam Learning has adopted IT into its curriculum. Its flagship program, Loud Class, is a tablet PC-based platform created for interactive studying purposes where students' responses can be shared and teachers can lead class through a tablet PC. It also allows teachers to customize their own content.
Hi, Linda. Good to see you.
There's a lot of countries or school districts that have tablets, but they don't know how to use tablets. It's like having a car without an engine. It looks great, but that's the only factor that goes in. So we're creating this engine that helps students, it helps the teachers, it helps the parents.
And the company is sharing this platform with the world. Recently, Cheongdam kicked off a Loud Class pilot program in Thailand.
The world is so small, connected with the ICT. So we think that having more and more experiences from outside that would benefit to our students.
Comparing Thailand and Korea's curriculum from the same grade, the president of IPST says there are some strong topics Thailand does not have yet and should be benchmarking from Korea, especially in terms of math and sciences. This is why industry observers note that in order to go global, it's not all about strong IT-based educational tools. They say Korean firms need to fully understand the level of education in their target market and localize their content to fit that market's needs. Kwon Soa, Arirang News.
And a good Monday morning to you all as we kick things off in baseball. Now on Saturday, the highest bidder for the Kia Tigers, Yang Yun-jung, was revealed to be the Minnesota Twins. But to everyone's surprise, the highest bid was once again a bit too low. Now despite many experts believing that Yang Yun-jung will be posted higher than Kim Kwang-yeon's $2 million, turns out it might not be the case. And some speculate that it might be in the $1.5 million range. While the lefty ace and the Kia Tigers were set to announce their decision on Sunday, they postponed their date to the 28th, with some stating that he might opt not to go overseas. Now, golf fans in the nation were getting excited over the CME Group Tour Championship this weekend, which was supposed to be the final showdown between Park In-bi and Stacey Lewis for the Player of the Year honors. But unfortunately for the 2013 LPGA Player of the Year, there is no repeat. Now, despite a decent start in the first round of the tournament, Park In-bi struggles in the second and third round of the event, shooting a 74 and a 73 respectively to finish the third round at 2 over par. And despite another round to go, the number one ranked Park was mathematically eliminated in the Player of the Year race, with Stacey Lewis set to take this year's top prize. And now shifting over to football, where FC Seoul and Seongnam FC squared off on Sunday for the FA Cup final at the Seoul World Cup Stadium. And despite FC Seoul being the heavy favorites going into this match, both sides were rather evenly matched as the game went scoreless for the first 90 minutes before another 30 minutes of scoreless football in the extra time. And with the FA Cup coming down to penalty shootout, Seongnam goalkeeper Park Jun-hyuk saves two shots to help Seongnam with 4-2 on penalties and claim this year's FA Cup trophy. And now finishing things off in Formula One racing, it came down to the final race of the season at the Abu Dhabi Grand Prix as teammates Lewis Hamilton and Nico Rosberg of Mercedes Racing fought for the championship. With Nico Rosberg needing all the advantage he can get, he does get the pole position after winning the qualifying race on Saturday. But a mechanical problem drops Rosberg early in the race as Lewis Hamilton takes advantage and wins his 11th race of the season for his second world title. A great season nonetheless for Nico Rosberg, who finishes second in the 2014 season, with Daniel Ricciardo of Red Bull Racing finishing in third behind the two Mercedes drivers. And that's going to wrap it up for me. This has been SJ. Have a great rest of the day and see you guys again for your sports needs.
Well, it's a gloomy day here in Seoul and the surrounding areas with a few sprinkles, but other parts have been receiving showers from early hours, and rain has been expanded to most areas, as we can see, compared to earlier hours, and it's going to rain all day long. Southern coastal regions in Jeju will see 20 to 60 millimeters, while the other parts of the southern provinces will see up to 40. But beware that the rain in the Gangwon-do provinces could turn into snow overnight. With that in mind, let's take a closer look at the readings for today. Now, the afternoon temperatures in Seoul will rise to 12, while Daegu and Gwangju will top out at 14 and 15, and Busan will peak at 16 this afternoon. And as for the other regions, Jeju Island will be getting up to 18, and Daejeon and Dokdo will see a high of 12 and 14 respectively. Now, temperatures will remain above the seasonal averages this week, highs hovering in the low teens in many areas, and there's a slight chance of light rain on Friday. Well, that's all for now. Let's send it back to Mark in the studio.
Thank you very much, Jeon, for the weather there. And that's all we have for now. We'll be back with our next newscast at noon, Korea time. Until then, goodbye.